I'm bringing up the dream team. Come on up. Yay. Ben Fisher. Yay. Katie Cooper. Yay. Nikki Garcia Holmes. Lamise Ahmad.
The model lesson that we're going to talk about was actually a lesson that Lamise did in her Arabic classroom, but it works for any lot. It's about healthy and unhealthy eating choices. So I'm going to talk about engage today. So to engage, you want to create interest. This is like your hook for the lesson. You want to generate curiosity, raise questions, and elicit responses that uncover what students know or think. So for this one, we used logos that are familiar to us in the Western world. So what are some of these logos that you guys recognize? McDonald's, Coca-Cola, and then we had a sad face or a happy face. So in your lot, what you could do, so for example, in Spanish, I would do me gusta or no me gusta.
We'll do like good or I like. Cuellos. Cuellos. Good job. Wow. Good job, guys. And then if you want to negate it, you're just going to add the part, the article mish in front of it. So you're going to say mish.
Mish.
Cuellos.
Mish.
Cuellos. Let's do it again. Mish.
Mish.
Cuellos.
Cuellos.
Wow, okay, you're on top of it. Good job. Okay,
so McDonald's, cuellos or mish cuellos? Mish cuellos. Okay. Starbucks. Cuellos. Coca-Cola. Mish cuellos. That's just a fun little example of an engagement that you could do. And so you can use this with any language. So for the second part of this engage, what we did was you'd have this in your lot. So para beber, para tomar, para comer, or in Arabic or French or etc. And so what we did was we had cards and they had the picture of this and they had the word in the lot. And so you'd have to decide, okay, this is like, this looks like a drink, and you'd say the word and you'd put it underneath a section. It goes in under the T chart.
I just want to add, this is such a great hands-on activity if they have these little things cut out in paper that they can manipulate and put them into two columns.
Yeah, they were on little note cards, yes. Okay. So have you guys started a class with a memorable engagement activity? What did you do? If you want to take a chance to turn to your partner. Okay, does anyone have an example they want to share? Maybe one or two? Yes, what did you do?
Was to divide the whiteboard according to the topics that we needed to cover that day. It was cultural, how to recycle in Italy. And I asked the students when they stepped in into the class to draw, you know, the bin container, the plastic bottle, or to write what they remembered. And so what happened was that some students may not remember, you know, how to say recycle in Italian or this kind of things, or the full complete sentence, but other students knew how to do that. So they completed and we had a full whiteboard full of concepts and ideas. And then after using that, I divided them into groups and they covered each of them a section of this lesson. I did the same thing, reversing, so dividing them into groups and then asking them to write. And in each group, there were some, you know, missing elements that were not covered because the people who knew that was into another group, assigned into another part. So that didn't work.
Practice before performance, right? Practice before performance. It works every time. Did anybody else want to share?
I did one with chores and tener que. And I made like a handout for the kids, and it was kind of like a bingo setup, and each little box had either a picture of a chore, or it just had like the actual vocab, like sacar la basura, or if not, I'll have a picture of doing like dishes. And I had kids have to get signatures. I told them, you know, you can only get two signatures per person, so they'll go around the classroom and say like, tienes que sacar la basura. And if it was like a yes answer, then they'll sign. If it was like, no tengo que, then okay, they'll go someone else and have. So it's kind of, they just kind of went around for like a warm-up as they were coming in.
Oh, my name is Ben Fisher. I am a German teacher and wannabe Spanish teacher. So I'm here to talk about exploration, which, as Rose said, is a very important component of this model that is not, I don't know if I could say unique to it, but it is very important and kind of fundamental in creating the learning environment that we want for our students here. In foreign language, and sometimes I was very scared, especially starting out, to introduce materials that were authentic foreign language materials that were not prepared by a book, because the rate of speech is very quick and they're using lots of vocabulary and things are scary. Using scaled activities, scaled to the levels that we know our students are at, we can make any sort of authentic material comprehensible, or at least something that the students can engage with and ask questions about. Exploration is all about collaborating with a partner or with a group they've experienced together. a recording, a TV show. They observe and listen to interaction, native speakers speaking at their natural rate and doing thing whatever native speakers do in your culture. And the teacher can provide probing questions and be on the side as a guide to the students to provide good questions, good ways of entering the material, and reminding them what skills they have to engage with the material so that they're not totally just out of luck, like all of a sudden, like, here's a Spanish language TV show, just have fun. We're giving them activities that are at their level with skills that we know that they can do, again, leading back to that objective that we come up with. So in the context of this lesson about a refrigerator, about foods, Lamisa's lesson, she was able to show a video of a Jordanian food market, which is our image on the left. The video itself does not have any Arabic spoken in it. It's not a narration of what's going on. It's simply Arabic language music playing behind a video of what's going on at the Jordanian food market. And so this is a level one class, so they're not going to be able to say, compared to an American, blah, 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 like this, this, and this. That's a little too elaborate, but they can list what foods they see, what colors they see. Any sort of personalities that they see associated with this market, using their listing skills, using the vocabulary that they already have. And you may introduce a sentence stem such as, I like this, in a way to engage with the material that they're looking at. So the Jordanian food market shows an authentic cultural context that they can engage with and describe. And then afterwards, you can have them discuss, like, what's the difference between this and maybe an American market. Our second engagement with a, or exploration rather, of a authentic cultural context is a Lebanese talk show. Lamise described this as Lebanese Jon Stewart. So it's comedic, it's lively and energetic. And of course, he's going to say a lot of stuff in Arabic that they might not comprehend right away. But he does use that sentence, I like this, I like that, to describe bananas and watermelons. And then shows a bunch of bananas, so like huge bunch. And a lot of students in America don't recognize that bananas come in bunches that are huge. They don't come in these little groupings of like 5 to 7 bananas. They come in just like, whoosh. So it's a way for them to see a different bananas in a different light. He's using a sentence stem, something that they've been prepped on, and they can engage with that video and be like, what is this talk show like? This man is singing and dancing around with bananas on a watermelon. That's interesting. That's something different for you. So those are two authentic cultural resources that are entirely appropriate to use in a level one Arabic setting. Even though there might be more going on in this market than we can describe, we've given them some tools to say, hey, you do know colors, you know some food. Explore it with that. What can you say about that? And they're getting an authentic cultural experience that they can draw on later. Same with this Lebanese talk show. Oh, I remember this talk show host. Now I can understand a little bit more what he's saying when they get to level two, when they get to level three. So even from the low levels, we want to let them explore real stuff. Beyond that, then there is a reading of four different student age people and Arabic speaking people that describe their diets. I eat this, that, and the other. I eat this, that, and the other. I like this. And then the students can explore, is that healthier or what is not healthy, which engages them with the broader question of what is a healthy diet, and something that we might consider healthy. I think it's healthy to not eat a lot of food. I think it's healthy to eat large quantities of healthy food. I think it's healthy to blah, blah, blah. Get them engaged with a broader cultural question about what does it mean to be healthy in your culture? What does it mean to be healthy in the target culture? So that guided reading provides questions like, is this person healthy? Why do you think that? And they can make that decision for themselves, talk with a partner, like, oh, I think it's better to eat lots of healthy food. Oh, you should probably eat smaller portions. Which lends itself to talking about the perspectives of the culture where those expectations came from. So I taught a variety of this for my German lesson, and we did a lot of very similar things, but instead of exploring a reading like that, I actually had them take a look at the equivalent, for those of us who might remember the food pyramid. It has now become the My Plate, and shows us how to divide up how we eat our food, so they get a look at that, and they might recognize that from Healthier PE. And then they look at the German version, the Der Ernährungskreis, which shows us how you're supposed to portion out your different kinds of foods throughout the day. And they can make a cultural comparison between that. Why is it laid out like this for Germans? Why is it laid out like this for Americans? What does that appeal to? What are the differences? What do they emphasize as healthy? Or what do they emphasize as something you need a lot of? And this is, again, just a way of exploring those perspectives of, what sort of information are these cultures getting about health and food? What is the government telling them? This is healthy. This is a staple of our diet. So that's, again, a way to engage with an authentic resource with guided questions and getting them thinking in the mode. As a little bit of an aside, when I taught another lesson, as part of my exploration, we were doing a very dry grammar topic. It's the present perfect tense in German, which is a way of describing the past. So their first introduction to the past tense. Grammar can be insanely boring. And one way to introduce topics like this is to just take some cultural thing and have them go on adventure. So this is Herr Nussknacker, Mr. Nutcracker. And he just went on a little adventure. Herr Nussknacker did this, he did that, he did this. And then we had little animation, him popping out behind things, around things and stuff like that. So he can show positions and he can talk in the past tense as well. What did Herr Nussknacker do? So, exploration. Research shows that if you share your lesson objectives with students, they learn more. Why would it make a difference? When's the best time to share it? When's the best way to share it? Turn and talk to your partners. 1, 2, 3, go. Who has an opinion on this? When's the best time to share an objective? How do you share it? How do you make sure students know what they're learning today? Yes.
Al principio, at the beginning of the class, you explain the objective, what they will be learning that day, and within certain time you will ask the students, so what are you learning? And they're supposed to tell you what they are learning, so they will stay focused on what they are doing.
Okay, yeah. So providing it at the beginning of class and then checking in along the way allows them to remind themselves, hey, I am accomplishing a learning goal. I am experiencing success.
I just have a lot of jobs in my class, and so a kid, that's their job to pop up and read the agenda and read the objective. And then later on, if someone doesn't know what's going on, we have a si se puede person that will inform them and help them out.
Awesome. Great.
And every time we start a new chapter, a new lesson, we have to post our objectives on the board. And as we start a new chapter, the new lesson, we explain to the students, but it's always...
And I have each unit's goal, so it stays up there all year. And then, you know, of course, the daily goal, we can, you know, so how does this fit into the big goal? But anyway, it's go for the goals. They're up there all the time.
Again, we try to emphasize the I can statement. It's worded in a way that kids understand the objective, and it's very simple. So it's not in any teaching jargon that only the teacher and the admin could understand, but the kids know what they're doing and what they're expected to be able to do.
Because in your lesson plan, you can write an objective, but when you actually share it, it needs to be an enthusiastic student language so that they buy into it. Because they're not going to really care about something like use the past tense correctly. They could care less about that. It needs to be turned into something real. Talk about what you did last week, that sort of thing. Marhaba.
Mumtaz wa alaykum assalam. Okay, so Anna Lamis. My name's Lamis. And today I'm going to just briefly touch on explain. Rose has covered explain in depth. What I want to reiterate is that for explain, the students were doing the explaining. I wasn't doing any of the explaining. There weren't even any instances where I needed to clarify anything. Sometimes there are, but not in this case. So I do want to really hone in on that, that the students in this section, they are the ones that did the explaining. And the explaining came from the videos that Ben mentioned, and also the reading. So for the reading, specifically, they had a graphic organizer. The reading was broke up into four sentences, four different parts, which discussed the diet of four different students. For this particular section was for the students to identify which of the four people in the reading had healthy diets and which four people didn't. And this sparked some interesting conversation because there was a specific instance when one of the people in the reading practically ate nothing. So some students in the class had said that this was healthy and some students said that this wasn't healthy. So that was definitely a very, very touchy subject for some students in this particular class, but it was really interesting to see this kind of conversation. And the conversation happened in groups of two, so it was practiced before performance because I didn't want to call on the students. Cold calling, as Rose had mentioned earlier, especially in Arabic. I tried to conduct this portion of the class in 90% Arabic because I wanted the students to learn the stem words that they had learned. I like, I love, or I don't like and I don't love, Quayas and Mishquayas. So in groups of two, they explained which one of the diets were healthy and which one of the diets were unhealthy by using the Arabic words. And then
I had opened up the floor for discussion, and it was really amazing to see where they explained to one another before they explained to the class. It seemed that they were prepared and they felt they had confidence, especially in the language. I mean, Arabic is not an easy language. I'm sure you guys have heard some of it. So they were able to explain to the class what they had learned, which was a great deal from the reading. They were using previous experiences to explain the concept. They were trying to explain why these diets weren't healthy, or why, in their opinion, for example, one of the students said that eating nothing was healthy because you could lose weight. It sparked a debate in class, which led to English, but it was, I mean, the fact that they were gauging and understanding was indeed a way of them, I guess, assessing their own progress. So that was definitely a reward for them. And I tried to incorporate in this portion of the lesson, these higher order thinking action words, right? So they described to one another, then they described to the whole class. They were comparing and contrasting these various diets, these various healthy diets and these various unhealthy diets, right? And they were also giving examples. Well, this particular person in the reading has a healthy diet because she eats fruit every day, right? They were also classifying and summarizing, right? Classifying which diets were healthy, which diets were unhealthy. Cuellas, right? Cuellas, or which diets were unhealthy. Mish cuellas, right? And then they were summarizing, right? They were summarizing which, you know, two students or three students in the reading had healthy diets or had unhealthy diets. Explain what works best for you. Do you write lesson plans on paper or online? Do you write lesson plans? Do you write plans daily or weekly? Do you collaborate or work alone? Let's take 3 minutes and discuss these various questions. Okay. واحد اثنين ثلاثة. Okay, ممتاز كويس. Okay, does anybody want to share?
I teach two classes, AP Spanish Language and AP Spanish Literature, and I am required to have printed lesson plans for every single class, every single day. So lesson planning definitely takes a lot of my time because there is a lot to do, and they require me to do the 5 E's for both classes. So there is a lot of work every single day.
You're familiar with it, mm-hmm. too, right?
I've been teaching for 14 years at the high school level, so I've kind of fallen off the other end and not really submitting my lesson plans every day, but I've been polishing up what I've been doing all along. University level, apparently, nobody's looking for lesson plans.
It depends on the department, to be honest. I know in our Arabic department, when we teach, we do require lesson plans in Arabic. So I just think it depends on your department. Yes. Well, yeah.
Yeah. I also want to add that at the university level, the professors have to submit a syllabus, and the syllabus is in a sense a little daily lesson plan. It's not quite the same as what high school teachers do, but the students know in advance what the topic is and perhaps things that are going to happen during the class. So it's a little bit different. I know that when I started at UT, and I realized I had to have all that together for the whole dadgum semester. You know, it's like a unit plan, and when do I start? So it was, there's a different approach.
Yeah. Great. Anybody else wanna share?
I have a question. Is there anybody that doesn't have to ever submit lesson plans? Raise your hand if nobody requires that of you. Now, here's my follow-up question to that. There were about 1, 2, 3, 4, about 7 of you that don't have to ever submit lesson plans. So those 7 who raised their hand that you never have to submit them, do you write them anyway?
Yeah. 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 Okay, thank you guys. Shukran, thank you.
Bonjour à tous et à toutes. My name is Nikki. I am a French teacher. It's nice to see you all today. I would like to talk to you about the elaborate E. So the elaborate E it gives you the students the opportunity to apply their new learning in unique situations. So in the elaborate stage, the students will make observations. They will draw conclusions. They'll ask questions. And they'll continue to explore and explain in this step as well, but using the newly acquired knowledge. And I would say that one of the most important aspects of this step is interaction. Interaction between the students. So that while they're elaborating, they can, you know, ask questions of each other, fill in those knowledge gaps, and discover something new. So for this lesson, for the elaborate stage, we had the students create a product. And so the product is a manila folder. Each student receives a manila folder, and this is their refrigerator. So let's start with the front. So imagine that this is the refrigerator door. One thing that we ask them to do is maybe what's one of your favorite quotations in the LOAT? Make some magnets, personalize it. What are you interested in, student? What are some activities that you might like? Do you like soccer? Make a soccer magnet. How do we say that in the LOAT? They can personalize this. And then when you open up the refrigerator door, we have an opportunity for the students to compare and contrast. So this is a French one. What would be in a typical refrigerator in France or whatever French-speaking country or, you know, the country from your LOAT country? And what would be in a typical refrigerator in the United States? So when the students are elaborating, they're, you know, drawing these conclusions, they're making observations, which foods are healthy and unhealthy in France versus the United States or in, you know, an Arabic-speaking country. So this really, it gives them a chance to be creative. They're asking questions, they're talking to one another. Oh, what do you think? What is your ami? What did you put on there? What did you hear about that? So they will create this product, and we encourage you to let your students take this home, make it really pretty, make it really nice, and then they can go into presentation mode and share this with the class. Now, another thing I want to stress is that this doesn't have to be a refrigerator. You can apply the same manila folder concept to so many other ideas. You can turn it like this, and now it's a suitcase. And you have what clothes would you take to visit this region that, you know, where it's cold, and what clothes would you take to the beach? This could also be a messenger bag. What school supplies do you have in your messenger bag? So you can really apply this to, you know, a lot of different themes and topics, and it really gives the students a chance to ask questions and explore further the concepts that they've just learned. Would you like to say something, Rose?
Did you sort of figure that one out? Yeah. I want to say a couple of things. The picture you see of Nikki, when we got together to prepare initially for this presentation, we did a short version of it at TEFLA this past year. I said, okay, we're going to make refrigerators. And so Nikki sat down and made this absolutely beautiful model. What's so important, and the reason I wanted them to do it, is because you really need a model. Mm-hmm. If the kids see something that awesome, then they can create something equally fabulous for you. If they don't see a model, then who knows what they're gonna come up with. So take the time yourself, not only by making the model can you make something awesome, but you can also see if it's possible and how long it takes. I remember we sat there doing it and they're like, this takes too long, I'll do it later. You know, but Nikki was like, I love to do this. So she was all involved in it, right? The other thing I wanna say is, I do wanna mention that in Lamisa's, I think, didn't you divide the shelves?
Yes.
Do you want to tell them
healthy
about that?
Unhealthy. Yes.
Yeah, tell them how you divided the shelves. Because that was her focus, was healthy and unhealthy.
Right. So on one side, I had them do the unhealthy foods, the mishkwayis foods, and then the kwayis foods. And I wanted them, my criteria for them before doing this, I actually stated that I wanted five foods for each category, so five different foods for each category, right? So unhealthy and unhealthy, and also five drinks. And a lot of them had chosen Middle Eastern foods. I mean, we know some Middle Eastern foods, right? What are some foods that you know?
Tabbouleh.
Okay. What else do we know?
Shawarma.
Kebab. What was it? Okay. Exactly. Yeah. So you guys know a lot, right? Falafel. Hummus. I mean, you guys know all these foods, right? So I had them do that. And then the same, and they already knew some of these vocabulary words. I knew tea, coffee, water. They already knew that, but I wanted them to put that into their refrigerator.
So go ahead and take 3 minutes. And consider the four E's that you have learned about so far. Engage, explore, explain, and elaborate. Which one would be the most challenging for you, do you think? And talk about why with a partner or in a small group. If you can hear me, snap once. Everybody turn and smile at Rose Potter, snap twice. All right, so what did you guys come up with? What do you think would be difficult for you?
To find a good piece to engage everybody.
Yes, yes. Finding something that really catches the students' attention. You know, I always try to incorporate popular culture or something like that, but I also think that the older we get, the harder that can be to do. good. And did you have something to say? There's always something going on, right? Kids are out, we have test days, there's, you know, constantly these interruptions to our lessons, and sometimes it can be hard to get everybody together on presentation day and make sure everybody is ready to go. And gosh, I sympathize with that.
I think that something that's very important to remember, so if you have 30 kids and five of them just aren't ready to present because they don't have anything, first of all, I would never have them do whole class presentation anyway because it's so time consuming and gets really boring. So I'd break them into little groups and have the kids that have no presentation, you can give them an additional task. I love the whole gallery walk where you put things up on the wall and the kids go by and can put sticky notes with comments on it, or they can have a comment sheet, or they can prepare, they can be critics for art, or they could be, you know, doctors looking at these refrigerators trying to decide if they think that they should, their diabetic patients should have that, or heart disease patients should have that. There are many, many ways that you can get those kids that didn't do anything to actually be involved in final products. And I think it's essential to do so because otherwise you will have problems, classroom management. So
I feel like explain could kind of be difficult because I feel like the way, as we saw in the video, the way the system is set up, our students are so used to, I've had students ask me, can you just make this a multiple choice test? Can we just have vocab, lecture, voc test on Friday? Like, they want that because they want to be told exactly what they need to regurgitate, basically.
So right.
Having them explain it in their own words, like, that would be challenging for me to teach my students that it's okay to do that and take those risks. Because they're used to being in the history class and the math class and expecting to say what the teacher wants them to say.
I looked up at that question, which I wrote myself, but I still always think of them in my mind as we go through this thing. I think explain for my students. I think explain is the most difficult part. We are trained as educators to be the explainers. Nobody ever told us that we weren't supposed to explain, and our students do expect it. So how do you solve this problem? And I truly believe it begins on day one, and you give students very simple tasks where they do explain, but they have success. So if you can get the pattern set up, you know, one thing that I absolutely realized as I was teaching is because I had established patterns of behavior. The kids came into my class, they sat down, they had to put their homework in the upper left-hand side of the desk. They immediately had a task where they had to talk with a partner. While they were speaking with a partner, I had my little stamp. I went by and stamped if they have completed homework. If they didn't, they didn't get a stamp. Then I always projected any kind of response if they were able to grade their own homework. Generally, they could. I showed them the answers. Did you guys get it right? Fix your work before you turn it in, because if they didn't turn their work in with fixed and repaired damage, then it was, they lost points. So I had, and then the next step was whatever else I was going to do, right? But they were so used to those routines. They know they're going to turn to a partner. I have to say that by the time I left teaching, and even before, probably 5 years before I left teaching, I never called on an individual student ever again until they'd had practice before performance. So I would walk into a Spanish class and say, hey, level one, right? In Espanol, hola, hola, hola. You're saying hola, right? They had never, they're like babies. Hola, hola. They say hola. And then say, tell your friend, tell your, in Espanol, dile a tu compañero hola. Tú, a tu compañero, hola, hola. And get them to do it, right? And then ask them, y hola en inglés, hola? And then they could explain it to you, right? Instead of me just telling them what to do. I got to the point where it didn't matter what the question was. I always said, habla con tu compañero. Pregúntale a tu compañero. Ask your companion. Ask the person next to you.
And that gave them that practice, and that builds their confidence. And when they have confidence, guess what? They will perform, and they're excited to do it. And your weak students are excited to do it because for the first time, they can. Because I can promise you, kids that come into the level two classroom, the level three and four that are just there for seat time, and there's so many that are, they just want the credit and get out. They have never experienced success in the classroom, and they think they can't do it. And as long as they think they can't do it, they won't even take a risk.
I wanted them to present to their peers. So I had them practice presenting to one another. One student presented on the cueyes foods, the healthy foods, and then the other student presented on the mishcueyes foods. So they practiced. All they had to say was, because I had given them the stem word and they had already learned this, but it was kind of to reiterate it. In our class, we had learned, Rose had taught us the importance of presentation mode. So I kind of used this group of students as guinea pigs to teach them what I learned, because they were they were freshmen. So they were, in a sense, unfamiliar with the concept of presentation mode. They have to stand up in front of their peers and not read off the paper. I didn't want them to read. So I had modeled for them my expectations of them. And this was maybe 2 minutes. I didn't want to spend too much time on this. And then each group went up and presented their presentation to the class. However, the other students in the audience, I didn't want them to just sit there and, you know, they tend to, maybe they're freshmen in their high school. I think at any age, it doesn't matter. They tend to daydream or not listen or get out their cell phones, which is something that I wanted to avoid 100%. So I gave them rubrics. Simple questions like, what did you like about the presentation? What advice would you give to perhaps improve different aspects of the presentation? So I had them filling out this rubric while their peers were presenting.
The only thing I might add is when I do this lesson, I do like the idea of a gallery walk as well. You could also have a little short survey for the students to complete as they're doing the gallery walk. I love the vote for your favorite, just so that the students who, you know, did really excel at the activity, have a chance to receive the praise of their peers. And I do a little award ceremony at the end, and the students who, you know, are in the, you know, top three or top five always blush, and they get a little piece of candy or a pencil or whatever. So I love that as an exit strategy, is, you know, voting for your favorite.
So when I did this for a German class, we were learning that there are a certain set of prepositions that you either use with one case in German or the other case in German, depending on whether you're moving it there or if it is stationary there. That is boring. So in doing this, we wanted to have them write a letter as if they're writing to a house sitter. Hey, I'm going to be gone. You can eat whatever's in my fridge. I'm going to tell you where it is. And so this was their way of their writing. So they had written a letter to their house sitter. And saying like, oh, I put the milk next to the eggs, and like the beef is underneath the spinach. I don't know. That doesn't seem safe.
That's what I was thinking.
We learned a lot about hygienics. But they have to describe, you know, how this and this letter to their house sitter. So in presenting, you know, they stand up, they read their letter aloud. And now, like, listening to this, I was like, well, how cool would it have been if they had had a little thing where they could draw in as they're listening, you know, like, oh, this person says that this is next to the this, so I'm going to draw that really quick, and like, no. And they could go slowly and take pauses, and then also have a rubric for how did this go, you know, what was going well in my, I'm going to say compañeros, like in my partner's fridge and stuff like that.
And I did a suitcase with my Spanish 3 kids, and so what I did for the evaluator at the exit strategy at the end was they all kind of chose where they wanted to go. So some people might have been going skiing, so they would pack like winter jackets, coats, and stuff like that. Some people were maybe going to the beach, so they would pack a swimsuit. And so I kind of did a gallery walk just in their groups, put them in groups of four, and they would just ask questions and try and figure out where the other person was going.
I want to mention that when you put all of this effort, and the kids have put all this effort into an activity and they've enjoyed it, it's really cool if you can think to yourself, could I reuse this or use this as a springboard for something else? So although we didn't ever talk about this, I'm sitting here thinking about this cool refrigerator plan, and something that I have done with my students in the past that this refrigerator could be a starting point for would be
the winners and stuff that you're talking about, let's take some of those. Let's take five of them, get in groups of four, and let's make a restaurant. And this refrigerator is our basic theme of the restaurant. And it can be a fabulous restaurant, or it can be like the worst restaurant on the planet, which has only bad food and horrible foods. And you're going to have terrible menu items and create a menu and have to put the prices down, and they have to have horrible food descriptions, or fabulous, whatever they want to do, right? But the refrigerator could be the platform, the jumping off point for that. So always take whatever you do and think, can I reuse this somehow? Can I expand this? And especially if it's something the students have enjoyed.
So I actually, for the first one, which is the healthier diet, American or the Middle Eastern, the Arabic, I had literally given them a ticket, an exit ticket, and I gave them the name in Arabic, what it was called. And then they answered this question in English. And then as they left the class, they passed it, they gave it back to me. And then we, of course, reviewed this. I wanted to kind of reiterate this topic the following class. So it was just literally a ticket, an exit ticket that they had presented.
How do you, the students are tracking their own progress? How do you do that?
Like, you need to include this many instances of this case, boring, or this case, but also as a comprehensible and stuff like that. So they can go along the way and check. I'll have like a checklist. The guidelines for the project are in checklist format, so they can say, I've included enough of this, so my letter is going to be comprehensible and have the requirements to communicate. So, yeah.
And I had mentioned this earlier. I had stated the criteria I wanted them to include, for example, the five healthy foods, five unhealthy foods, and then to use the stem word I like or I don't like. That was that was kind of to see what I had expected of them, and which I also wanted them to use. So it was just to kind of self-check themselves. That was a very simple way of doing it. I'm sure there are many other ways.
Actful kind of statements that you can get a search engine and download all of them if your district hasn't introduced you to them or your team has not introduced you to them. If you've not gone to ACTFL, to their website, there's so many different types of support for you there, so I strongly encourage you to do it. The can-do statements, it's so fabulous. Why didn't we think about that 40 years ago? You know, just what can you do? And letting the students know what they've accomplished. Because we have a few extra minutes, I would like the students to talk a little bit about the overview of the lessons that we have. As we looked at every student's section, okay, so see where Katie's name says engage, and down it says stereotypes, level 3, pre-AP. You'll find that she has a lesson plan. The theme is stereotypes, and the entire lesson is available for you to download and to use. And what I'd like to do now, and they're going to describe the plan to you.
So for this lesson, if you found a video for another LOAT, you could absolutely apply it to another LOAT, but the videos are in Spanish. Our vocabulary during this unit was characteristics, and so I kind of wanted to take characteristics to a higher level to just have like deeper conversations. So what I did was I found this awesome video about a lot of their ex-gang members in Mexico City, and they are part of this bicycle club. And they kind of just rebuild old, like, bicycles, not motorcycles, and they ride around on Sundays. And a lot of them used to be members of rival gangs, and so a lot of them have tattoos. So it's kind of just one of those videos. You kind of breaks your preconception. A lot of people have preconceptions, and that's natural. But so what I did was I had, for the engage, I had a little screen cap from that video of just a man's face with lots of tattoos, and just asked them simple, what do you think of this man? Do you think he's a good man? Do you think he's a bad man? Why do you think he's a bad man? Why do you think he's a good man? What's your opinion? So a lot of them were like, oh, he's probably bad because he has face tattoos. And it's like, well, why does that mean that he's a bad person, you know? And there was another video in there as well, and it's about these women in Bolivia. So you get the culture of Mexico kind of in that lesson, and then these women in Bolivia who are a little older, in their 40s or 50s, and they scale these mountains in their traditional clothing, and it's just one of those really cool little short stories. They're kind of like BuzzFeed videos almost, but in Spanish. So they're really good for the language classroom. They have little, it'll be all in Spanish, and then I'll have kind of like a little summary in Spanish, so it's all the LOAT. And so what we did was, before watching two videos, I had some note cards, so they'd have a picture. One of them was like a fish from SpongeBob, and he had like a tattoo that said mom, and then it was like tatuaje, which is the word for tattoo, so they had to match those together with the descriptions. So I had the word and the description in the LOAT, and then they matched it with the photo. And then we went over those. so that they have some vocabulary before we watch these videos. After watching the videos, they had a worksheet that had kind of a little T-chart, and it said, before watching the video, this was what I thought. Elaborate. So, antes de ver el video, so before they watched the video, this is what they thought. What did you think before watching? I thought, so I gave them some stims so they can talk to each other afterwards. And then what do you think now? Well, now I think, blah, blah, blah. So they're just really kind of a little deeper level talking about what their opinion was, like when they judged this person just based on like looking at a photo, and then after learning a little bit more about them, what do they think now? And then for evaluate, they wrote a short paragraph or an essay. And you don't have to do an essay for this if you don't want to. You could do more of like a class discussion or a debate, but I had them do in their journals, just write a little quick, like, what do you think now? And what do you think about judging people initially based on their reactions? What changed your mind, et cetera? And then I had them include an example that they could say from their own life or just from our culture in general. Like, what is an example of someone you have seen that was judged based on a prejudicial, like, initial reaction? And so I got a lot of interesting ones. Like, someone was like, oh, the people that are athletic are dumb. You know, just stuff like that. A lot of it was light. And then the exit strategy, we didn't do this one, but we did.
I like this one a lot.
Yeah. I think we ended up saying, like, would you get a tattoo? Or, like, what would your parents think if you got a tattoo?
For my lesson was a lesson prepared for a German 1 class about weather, which is, again, just a kind of straightforward topic. They're like, okay, we have to talk about the weather. And for this one, I did want to incorporate in authentic cultural materials. So the engagement was a simple question. Are you a winter person? Are you a summer person? Gets kids talking. I'm this person. I like to do this, blah, blah, blah. And then beyond that, we start exploring the vocabulary for weather. And then the students have a chance to actually watch the Tagesschau, which is the German everyday news broadcast. And it is very quick rate of speech. There's not a weather presenter on the board who's like, oh, this, that, and the other. Like, come on, Jim, tell us it's going to be sunny out there. And he's like, I can't, it's Germany. There's none of that. And so it's a different sort of presentation of the weather. And so the students get to explore that with guided notes. Like, what do you notice about the presentation? Also, everything's in Celsius. Why are the numbers so low? It must be freezing in Germany. Actually, it's fine. Don't worry about it. So this is a chance for them to engage with the cultural element of Fahrenheit and Celsius, but also how weather is just presented. That's a thing that we kind of take for granted, I think. So that's part of the exploration. The explanation is the students being able to talk about what they saw and compare Fahrenheit and Celsius, and if someone knows that conversion, how they, you know, try to remember easy tips for that. Elaboration, and a bit of the exploration as well, that they go onto the equivalent of weather.com and just start clicking around on that, because the German version is great, has lots of little pop-up things. It's this middle thing right here, where if you hover over that cloud, for instance, say there's lots of clouds and not a chance for sun or anything like that. So students get to explore another resource that a German person would use on their day-to-day, like, I'm just going to check weather.com to see how it's going to be. And then to elaborate, I had students split up. A cool idea that we came up with way later was, like, what if we researched the partner cities of the city where you live and then had students do those all around the world? So you're making a geographic connection to... why are we partnered with these other cities? Do we have sister cities around the world? And what's their weather like at the same time that we're experiencing this weather here? It allows you to make another geographic comparison. If you don't have sister cities, or if you just want to have a broader geographic scope, you can say, we want to do a couple people on each continent and different parts of the continent, or maybe even different parts of your country. For instance, there's a big difference between being in the Alps in Germany and being in the flatlands or over on the Rhine. So you can kind of break people up however you see fit and based on what your objective is there. To give them broad geographic, I was like, the whole world. And so everyone got a post-it and had to write the name of their place, what kind of the range of temperatures was, if it was sunny or any, using that vocabulary they had just learned. And then describing whether or not they think it would be a great idea to travel to that place. So everyone goes up and can put a post-it on a world map saying, you know, this is the weather in this region right now at this moment in time. And then can kind of compare, like, oh man, it's really nice here, but dang, Germany's getting hit with a bunch of water, with either snow or rain or whatever it might be. And then they can kind of compare. And so at the end of class, they get to decide as a class, that we're all going to take a trip. Where are we going to go? What sort of weather do we want? What do we prefer? Because what sort of activities do we want to do? So again, incorporating students' opinions, using authentic resources that Germans would use to find more information about the weather. And it was a lot of fun. At mine, I said, whatever city is of interest to you. And so a lot of students were like, I want to go to Pyongyang. because they're interested in North Korea. It's kind of a joke. You can't get weather for Pyongyang very easily. So they kind of approximated what northern Japan's weather was like. And then we're like, it's probably like this over here in Korea. And I was like, that's very creative and weird. So it was kind of a chance for them to express themselves a little bit. And they had a lot of fun with it. And it was pretty cool. So.
Okay, so for my lesson, I wanted the students to focus on the Egyptian coffee house. So since this was predominantly the focus was culture, so I tried to encourage students to keep the class at the 90-10, the whole 90-10 concept of 90% Arabic and then 10% English. So for the engagement activity, I had students, as they were walking in, I handed them a T-chart where they would compare what coffee houses or what cafes in the United States looked like, and then on the other side was what their expectation of an Egyptian coffee house might look like, which is more of a traditional setting for those of you who might not really know too much about that. So when students, for this portion, they wrote in English. So I had them just quickly write down, I wanted them to write at least three different things for each side. So they quickly wrote this down, and then I wanted them to just talk about it in pairs, you know, what they had wrote and compare their expectations and also what their observations for what American style coffee houses or cafes look like. And then we opened the floor for discussion. And it was really, for this particular activity, it was really beneficial because usually with this is for Arabic too, forgot to mention that, for Arabic too. For this kind of activity, I wasn't really expecting the non-heritage speakers to know too much about Egyptian-style coffee houses, so it was a really good opportunity to encourage the heritage speakers, or at least speakers who had more of a background, whether they were their parents were from Pakistan or India, they might have more of an idea, especially those who had an Islamic background. For this particular class, that was the heritage speaker category. So they contributed a lot to the conversation. I didn't want to do the speaking and explain, so I relied heavily on those students, and I was very impressed with their performance because they did want to engage and want to explain to their peers, this is what it's like. This is, you know, I'm speculating because I've never been to Egypt, but this is what it's like. And you know, they were correct. Their expectations of what it might look like was actually spectacular. And then so this is just briefly what it looked like for the engagement. And then for the exploration, I had given them a menu that I wanted them to look at. And we also watched a video where I gave them a graphic organizer with specific questions. What does money look like? What currency do they use? They, you know, the Egyptian pound, they call it the guinea, Egyptian pound. Just various things in the video that I wanted them to look for. Also, what kind of, in an Egyptian coffee house, you don't see food, you see drinks. So what kind of drinks would they see? Various kinds of coffees, tea, water, juice. And then for things that weren't addressed in the video, specifically with what the types of drinks, I gave them an authentic menu that I just found online. So I printed that out and then gave them. I wanted to keep the materials as authentic as possible. It proved challenging, you know, sometimes because especially with the level of the video, I wanted to keep it somewhere at that I+1, right, that one level above what they were at their present level. So for the explanation, they once again, I did the whole the pair and chair, had them work in partnerships and quickly practice before they performed, right, to discuss what they had understood from the video, what they had gauged, and a lot of it was just visual. They didn't have to understand too much of the language in the video, and even on the menu, they knew the words. They knew the basic words: water, coffee, tea, juice, different kinds of juices. So for the elaboration, after they had discussed it in pairs and we had all discussed it as a class, I gave them criteria of what I expected because I wanted them to create their own cafes in groups of four. So I wanted them to have a menu. I wanted them to have currency. I wanted one person to play the garçon, in which, I mean, is, I believe from French, right, for waiter or waitress. In the Middle East, you don't really see too many waitresses in this kind of coffee house. So that was a cultural aspect that actually one of the heritage speakers brought up while I was discussing the criteria for their coffee house. So that was a good point to be made. And then after they had created their coffee houses, I wanted one person to play the garçon and then the other people to be, the other students to be customers. So they would go, there were four cafes, so four groups of four cafes. So one person was the garçon and then the other three would rotate to each cafe and visit. I wanted them to visit as at least two just because of time constraints. So they were able to visit at least two and they were going to order what they wanted and they were going to pay for it. So I tried to incorporate some math skills. And of course, this was all in Arabic. They were doing this in Arabic. I had to remind them a couple of times to stay in the language, but they knew the words. That was actually something that I meant to mention in the beginning. So while I was stating their criteria, we briefly went over the words and expressions like, I want this, I want coffee, I want tea. We just briefly reviewed because this was stuff that I wasn't teaching them or they hadn't learned that day. This was just kind of reiterating what they had learned prior to this particular lesson. So for the evaluation, since they worked in groups and that was one of the objectives, I wanted each person to fill out this evaluation of how successful or perhaps, you know, something that they might want to work on in the future while working in groups. Did one person do more work than, you know, another person? Did they feel like that it was a successful, you know, collaboration or moment to collaborate? Why not? So that was my form of the evaluation. And then for the exit ticket, I wanted them to write Yelp reviews. So they had the opportunity to visit at least two coffee houses. So that means they didn't visit just one, right? Because one of them was their cafe. So each person had an exit ticket and then they wrote which cafe was the best cafe in their opinion and why. And they wrote this in English. I wanted them to write this portion in English. Because I wanted them to really, to kind of reinforce or kind of, I guess, to make sure that they knew the objective of the activity. And they actually had some interesting feedback and interesting points about why they thought one cafe was better than the other. So it was definitely a fun activity.
All right, so the lesson that I did was based on connections through music. One thing that I noticed when I was teaching high school is there's always several students who want to keep their earbuds in all the time. And why is that? Because young people love music. It resonates with them. It connects with them. They're going through the period of storm and stress in their life. So I wanted to do a lesson that incorporated culture, also a little bit of geography. So this lesson is based on stations. We had five stations. They're color-coded. So there's a placard at each station. Each station has a different colored placard with a QR code on it. You can also put the URL of the video that they're going to watch at this station, because each station, they can either scan the QR code, put in the URL into their cell phone. If you have classroom laptops, that works as well. And oh, I guess I missed the engage. So we engage with a video, engaging music video in your LOAT. So then the students are in groups. They rotate at each of these stations. Each station has a different music video, sometimes a couple of music videos that they would watch. The color coding is for the stations is because they also have a task packet. So we have a different colored sheet in their task packet that corresponds to each station. And on that task packet are going to be questions. So as they're exploring, watching those videos, they're going to explain to you what they've learned. It's really important to me teaching French that we don't just focus on France all the time. There are many countries that speak French. So for my lesson at each station, there was a music video and an introduction to a musician from a different part of the French-speaking world. We had Louisiana French, Zydeco, Zachary Richard. We had a Quebecois indie pop artist. We had some techno. We had Josephine Baker from, you know, France back in the old days to introduce these students to these different genres and these different epochs. And so then they do elaborate, they apply their new learning. There's optional questions at the bottom of each task packet. So in addition to having their first four questions on each sheet are the same, do I like it, do I not like it? What genre is this? Circle one, is it le pop, le country, le rap? There's these additional things that they can use to take their learning further. So interviews, leave a YouTube comment on this video, or leave an Instagram comment for this rock band. So they're elaborating. another thing that we did was the evaluate. They did vote for their favorite. I do like the voting. So they did this on the board. Then we had a little discussion, a class discussion, as to why this was your favorite. What did you think of this or that?
Now, I want to mention one more time, remember this little link here? There are five culture lesson plans there that are 5E's plans that are adaptable to any LOAT. So when you hear the students talking about their lesson plans, be aware that you can go pull them up and make them your own and use them.